So yesterday we took our pretest on inheritance, and today we're going to get started with that unit. So to start that off, I'm going to show you a video clip. So when I try to decide my anticipatory sets, I try to use a variety of different strategies. One way is using interesting video clips. And I can go on YouTube or Vimeo and find these interesting and engaging videos. I had them watch a video on an introductory to genetics as my anticipatory set. So I wanted to get them engaged and hooked into the content. And so this was like a trailer format. And so it got the students to really get excited about what they're about to read, which was inheritance and genetic variation.
9.22
seconds. So today, you're going to underline major points. You're going to circle keywords or phrases. I need to see two questions. If there is anything that surprises you, use that exclamation mark. Okay. If you do find a connection, you make those connections. As time goes on, more and more connections will be made. So if you don't feel stressed out if you can't find any. And then an EX for examples. After the video, I reviewed what close reading was. So they didn't really have a lot of experience with close reading. In the first weeks of school, we had kind of looked at close reading. We looked at like what was underlining major points, circling keywords. That was pretty much it. But the very short piece of text that was highly engaging, just to kind of get them comfortable with the process. Some were more experienced with it because of teachers they've had in the past. Others had no experience. So this time around, I really want to spend some time on just reviewing what close reading was again, emphasizing that you read first without doing anything to the text, and that the second time you read, you're going to annotate. And I added a couple new pieces. So I want them to continue underlining the major points, circling those keywords or phrases, but I wanted them to also add questions. And I gave them a specific number of 2 questions, only to, you know, hold them accountable for that piece. So rather than just 1 question, you know, want to. And later on, eventually, I take away that number. So during close reading, it is an independent task for students. What I don't want to do is I don't want the students to feel as if the way they're annotating in that portion of close reading, that it is incorrect and that they are doing it wrong. The purpose of close reading is to get the students to really stop and think about what they're reading. And if they underline something that they think is a major point, after having read very closely the text, well, then they've already achieved the purpose of close reading, which is to really stop and think about what you're reading. You put down what you thought were keywords, you circled those. You put down what you thought was an example, right? You had questions, you put those down, right? Those are your thoughts, the annotation. So you're gonna be sharing those with your partner, not all of them. Okay? So an important piece of close reading is having those text-dependent pieces. And one of those pieces are text-dependent discussions where students actually speak to each other about the text. And I like to call this like sharing your thoughts.
For section 1, I put mutations are genes, changes that can result to changes in two proteins.
That conversation piece is important because it gets the students to reflect even more on what they had read. And it builds up to that text-dependent questioning piece, which the purpose of those text-dependent discussions is it slowly builds confidence with the text. So, you know, that first read is usually uncomfortable. The second read is still uncomfortable. The text-dependent discussions and then the text-dependent questions, it just leads to the students becoming more and more comfortable with the text because of that repeated going back to the text.
9B, Brianna.
Okay. Some changes are beneficial, others harmful, and some neutral to the organism.
So after I had them share, I did randomly call on some students to share their answers. As I go around during their text-dependent discussions, I am hearing a variety of different answers. But I also like the students to hear other students' answers from across the room. And from the reason I do it, it's also an accountability piece. So you need to be prepared with some type of answer to share.
The genes produce proteins from which in turn gives eyes their color.
What I want you guys to look at next is I want you to look at how would I have annotated. I'm not going to go through the whole thing. I'm only going to look at section 2. Don't change yours because I do something different from you. Don't. That's not right or wrong. I just want you to watch my thought process. Watch how I do this. How would I have taken this text and annotated? I'm going to look at section number 2. So I've already read it for the flow. So I modeled the close reading because I wanted the students to see how it could be done in one way. I could have students model the text. But I also, if you notice, I did the modeling after they had already close read the text. I didn't model before. Part of close reading, one of the big things is to limited front loading. You want to limit the front loading of vocabulary and of modeling. You want the students to struggle with the text. That's part of the learning process. But also after they had struggled with the text, I modeled it. So there was, they can make those connections. So in this lesson, after they had annotated, had their text dependence discussions, I just closed the lesson with the starting of their Cornell notes, where they were getting information from the text, the most important points, and putting that down on their notes. So the notes will be an ongoing thing that they'll be completing. They're constantly going back and referring to the text. So they'll have multiple opportunities to continue adding notes. So on the second day for close reading, what I did was, that was the big text-dependent discussion piece. What I did differently this time was I used technology to ask my text-dependent discussion. So I used Nearpod, and I had created a series of text-dependent questions that started at a lower level of complexity and increased in complexity. So I had originally started with like words, starting at the level of the word, and then slowly built up to sentence, and then whole paragraph structure. And then even at some point, getting to comparisons of that text to another text. In this case, it was a video. And when the students are assessed on Common Core, all the questions are text dependent. So getting to analyze text closely in the class, when they do get a text, let's say on Smarter Balance, the students are going to have those skills to, you know, how do I look for a major point? Okay. How do I know what are some key words? And what's going to happen is those text-dependent questions are going to be formulated around that. So if the students are used to analyzing a text very closely, when it gets time to answering text-dependent questions, they're going to be a lot more comfortable.